3 weeks or so since our last meeting. And then you have received, you received it by email last week, but also we distributed another copy of the scheduling parameters outline that we've developed over the last couple of weeks, last couple of meetings. And we've asked representatives from the Arts Festival specifically to be here today to address the scheduling parameters. And then that's basically going to be, the committee may have a discussion on that, but time permitting, but that's basically going to be the meeting for today. Next week, the meeting is going to be primarily dedicated to public comment. In fact, we will start the meeting with the public comment so that everybody has an opportunity to speak and address the issues, so there's not going to be squeezing you in at the last minute or after some of the committee members have to leave because of business commitments. So that's the approach. So I don't know, were these available for members of the
public? Yeah,
so for each of the committee members in front of you, this is the, as I said, the outline of the scheduling parameters that David and I have developed as a result of the last three meetings, dealing basically primarily with the scheduling of the Arts Festival. It has broken the topic down into the subcategories of when the meetings will, when this, what we've been referring to as the bookends, when the festival would start at the beginning of the year, when it would finish at the end of the season, as well as sort of off-season or shoulder events. It addresses the frequency and the number of events. It covers the intensity of the different events. We sometimes refer to it as sort of Tier A and Tier B type of events, larger concerts versus smaller things. Then we dealt with performance times, and we briefly, at the end of our last meeting, dealt with sort of the program type and mix. Again, this is not etched in stone. This is really was meant to be a synopsis of our conversations last time around. Again, our goal here is by early September to be able to provide John with the committee's report on what we think, what we recommend that the city incorporate into its license agreement next year, and allow the city to work with the Arts Festival and allowing them to go forward with their schedule in the fall instead of having to wait till next spring. So that's kind of the outline of how I see it going today. Do anybody in the committee have any questions? All right, then I'll invite the Arts Festival to come on up. And
you guys want to sit there? I mean, we don't bite. Not hard.
Introduce everybody.
Yeah, if you could let us know for the record your name and where you're from. And
so I'm Jamie French, Portsmouth, chair of the board of the festival for the third time of my life, but and we of course have Ben Anderson and Ken Bellevue, who lives in Portsmouth, who is the vice chair of the board, and Joel Harris, who is the on the board now and downtown restaurant owner and sponsor, long-term sponsor of the festival. So he brings a perspective of the sponsors, and so
sure.
I don't know what you'd like us to do.
Well, okay, well,
because we have, you know, we can go through with specific comments about each of the areas, but maybe some overviews. But John, you had some generic things you wanted to talk about first.
What I would like you to do is, by the end of your presentation, address everything in here that you want. If there are things that don't matter, then you don't need to. But this is really going to be the opportunity to get the feedback on it. So I don't want to, you know, control how you want to make the presentation. If you want to skip back and forth, that's fine.
Trees and greenery? Excuse me, you looking for trees and greenery?
Yes.
Fourth floor.
Fourth floor.
Yeah.
Okay.
Take the left up the elevator.
So I'll leave it to you.
That's fine. Yeah, no, I think what I'll do is just do a couple of overview comments and then let Joel and Ken, if they want to do that, and then let Ben go through the specific details of different impacts of different things. So, you know, my overview of nearly 40 years of involvement with the festival, I guess 39 or 38 years, is I've seen, and as of course I think many people know, I also served for 17 years as a trustee of the trust fund. So I had both the arts festival perspective in the, you know, in the earliest days, and when the Theater by the Sea, I was in town when Theater by the Sea was doing the plays, and the trustees were completely financially supporting everything that happened in the park. There were two plays this summer, and the Shaw Brothers and other things that happened. That was in the late 70s. And then I was also very much a part of the scene when the trustees of the trust funds decided that they were running out of money. In those days, the trustees of the trust funds were spending 15-17% of the Prescott Trust. If we had put the clamps on spending at the arts festival,
you gotta put your microphone a little closer.
If we put the clamps on the spending of the trustees of the trust funds back in the 70s, and they hadn't done the spending the income when they put all the money into bonds in the times of high inflation, and we're spending $250,000 a year, et cetera, et cetera, these Prescott Trust would probably be $7 or $8 or $10 million now and not what it is today. So there was a free spending policy that was not necessarily prudent. And when I came on as a trustee, we quickly tried to change that to a spending, total return spending policy, and do a budget that was sensible in relation to the thing. So you end up with the festival being, the funds being pulled in the early 80s, and the community being involved with saving, bringing the festival back, a broad-reaching community outreach to raise the money to keep the festival going. A lot of that support came from the downtown restaurants and merchants and the community. Everybody forgets we have this booming community today, but some of us who were here in those times, and it was not that way. And the restaurants were desperate to have midweek business. They could get weekend business, and the stores and the shops and the festival was the economic driver. This was before the music hall. This was Theater by the Sea was on its suffering, on its last legs. The arts festival was the. I'll never forget when we did the community cornerstones vote for the community of what were the most significant things in the community, and Prescott Park and the Prescott Park Arts Festival came out as the number one by far of the beloved community things for the this was in the 80s. So fast forward, you've had two or three other different periods of time when the festival was on the verge of financial collapse. There has never been any endowment for the festival. There's a tiny little endowment that we started back in the 80s with the Greater Piscataway Community Foundation. Joe Sawtelle put some money on the table, which I got matched. It's less than 50 grand, I think, at this point. It never really took off. The trustees of the trust fund spent many, many efforts to try and get money. Endowment built. We did a lot of work with lawyers and state planners, and hoping that people would leave money directly to the festival to build up an endowment, so you'd have enough money to support. We had rainy summers, and where the festival would be 50, 60, 70,000 in the hole on a tiny budget, and we'd have to have winter events and fundraisers to try and raise enough money to open the festival again. That has happened periodically over the last 35 years. In the last decade, the leadership that's been there has turned the financial viability of the festival around. However, that said, yes, there have been some good years. Last year was a drought, a severe drought, and we had virtually no cancellations because of weather. And even so, the financial viability of the festival was about break even. And so a year like this that we're bringing, it's a rainy summer. And I don't think the community really understands, because we've had a series of fairly good years and viability, that the financial uncertainties of an outdoor festival with no covered stage are very risky. And that if you provide parameters that are so restrictive or prevent flexibility in scheduling and abilities to drop in a concert or to do other things like that, you take away a great part of many of the moving pieces that make a festival financially viable. A lot of the things that have come into place over the last few years, better concessions, the rented chairs, the things that have been done to enhance, to make sure that we do get some kind of a donation from people that aren't members of the festival. And remember that 500 families get buttons, that people that can't afford it. That those are all create a financial stability that that the festival has now has. Although we say that, everybody has this perception that the festival is this very wealthy organization. For a 43-year-old entity in this community, you know, you've got less than 8 months of liquid assets in the budget.
Jamie, I just want to ask you a question, because you talk about the financials, and that's going to, you know, Ken, our major discussion will be about the number of nights that might be dark, et cetera. Can you provide us with the financials and the 990? We've been asking for those and haven't gotten them as of yet. So I can take a look and analyze them and see how the financials would be affected if, you know, just take a look at those. So we haven't seen the 990, I suppose.
Or 16.
And the financials.
So the 990 status, we are the way a nonprofit accountants work. They tend to do their work after their corporate clients are finished, and that ends in the March season. So the work on our 990s are being done now, and we should have them by within the next 30 days.
Right, and I guess what I would say is that's going to be a key for us, because I'd like to take a look at those. Yep. The financials, I don't think we've seen any financials at all.
But you would have seen last year's, but when was the last time you provided them, Ben?
Within
the
last
December 31, okay.
So you'll get them. We will provide you with the first 6 months of financials. And
just a couple items. I think I did review them a couple years ago. And are you still using depreciation on that for city buildings? I think you need to take a look at that for your accountant. Talk to your accountant about that.
Ken, you're the finance committee.
You shouldn't be depreciating city buildings.
On the equipment, not the building.
Just the equipment.
Just equipment. Okay.
No, we stopped doing that, I believe, last year.
Okay, very good. Thank you. So, as soon as you can get them, because that's going to be a key part.
We will do that. So the general, without going into more detail, but I do think it's important to get the context of the financial viability. And I just want to remind people that when you look at other nonprofits in this community, and I know several of them pretty well, in terms of the amount of time that they've been in this community, the financial, we have put aside a couple $100,000 of quasi endowment. There's $50,000 in the community foundation, and there is 6 months or so of budget liquidity in the organization. So if we had a rained out summer, which this summer is looking pretty risky, we've so far so good, but you could very quickly run through the reserves of the arts festival, and you could be back in a situation where the festival was really financially unviable. So that would be my overview. And I just want to talk, as we go into the specifics, that, you know, the moving parts of keeping of a festival operating in generic terms of different communities. I mean, I relate this to the music hall. The music hall has been successful because it has programming for all the different types of audiences in our community, and that it's really, really important to have some flexibility. And when we talk about the specifics of things like the movie night, sounds like an easy thing that you could remove. You know, there's, why not get rid of Monday night? Well, it turns out that, you know, Monday night's movies are actually the highest concentration of Portsmouth residents. And it's a different type of audience. I mean, people aren't going to drive from
Rochester to watch a 25-year-old movie. It's locals, it's families, it's a very, very, very affordable night out, and it's a simple, so is, that's a very much a community thing. Outdoor movies seem to be very popular now. We tried it 25 years ago, and they weren't very successful. You know, we didn't, they were mixed, of mixed success. So the types of programming that we have from and range do appeal to as broad a range of the community as you possibly can get. And when you start taking away flexibility and restricting things, you do have impacts on that diversity of our community and our mission. So I think with that, Joel, you want to just make a few comments?
Sure, I'll be brief. Just to echo what Jamie had to say, as a board member and also as a downtown business owner, we've been a sponsor since 2003, really since we've opened every summer. The park is extremely important to us and our summer business. I'd say particularly the current schedule at 6 days a week. On Monday they had a movie night, and that was our second busiest day this summer. So the park really draws people down to our end of State Street, which is can be a little sleepy. You know, downtown, the square is particularly busy, and as the city pushes towards the West End and more development out that way, the end of State Street where we are tends to get a little lost in the shuffle. So having an attraction like the park to draw people down there is great for us, and we, you know, do all we can to support them. Mondays is particularly a slow day for restaurants and for businesses, so having the movie night, having locals come down and spend money in local stores and restaurants is really great for us. So just to echo the current schedule and support of that as a resident and a business owner.
I think one, I don't want to get Ken, but I think one thing that I meant to mention that's really important to know is that reducing the schedule does not have much impact. It has no impact on the expenses. So it's a revenue reduction, and the expenses are going to stay virtually the same. There's very little, very little direct expense related to the revenue when you start reducing the schedule. Ken, do you want to make any comment about financials?
Yeah, this is the second time I've been on the board. I was on this board about 15-plus years ago. It was totally different. You know, we had a rainy summer that year, and they were passing the hat around at our meeting saying we got to come up with about $200 a person, $500 a person. It's a viable operation now. It's a pleasure being on a board like this. I go to a lot of the different performances down there. I've seen some of you there. I am still amazed at the variation of the group that shows up. You know, Lake Street Dive, I thought was gonna be all young people with me there. It was a wide selection of people there. I've been to the plays, I'm even shocked there. You see the grandparents right down to grandchildren all sitting there. So I think what the programming has been concentrating on from movie night to the concerts to everything is to offer something for everybody in the community, and I think we've been very successful at that. Being on the finance committee up until I became vice chair, it is true, the actual expenses are set for the year, so what you're talking about in reduction is our profitability going forward. And that is something that I think Ben and previous boards have worked very carefully on to make sure that we're a profitable organization offering high quality performance. Not just a few kids down there from town putting on a show. They're in the play, but it's a great production. The choreography and everything is at a higher standard. People love to come to the shows that we have down there. So
that's.
Can I ask a question just about what you both just said, because it doesn't. I understand a better opportunity to look at financials would help with this, but obviously it can't be. If what you just said was true, you wouldn't be paying any of your outside acts, and I know that's not true. So, you know, the fixed costs aren't totally fixed. You've got an overhead rate in there on top of a cost, and having run performing arts organizations myself, I know it's all about input and output, and that the best way to lose money is to program every night, usually, in a performing arts venue. So how do you think about, I mean, there is fixed costs for employees, et cetera, but then obviously there are your variable costs that represent how you think of overhead or how you think of a cost on a fee, because if you didn't pay a fee for a particular night and you were dark that night, you wouldn't have some of the expenses related
right.
to that.
So I think Ben
how,
would be,
how do you think about
well,
that?
Well, the prop, for example, is revenue oriented. If we don't have a performance that night, the prop isn't going to make money
right.
on food services.
Right.
The fixed costs for the lighting and the sound projection, everything else is already there.
Right.
Yes, we have the performance cost on that stuff.
Right, but do you have you calculated like what your overhead costs are as a percentage so that you can think about the variables that go into play here?
I think one of the things that we get is that because of the variable of the weather and the, you know, you can have an expensive event
right.
that we expect
right.
to have a huge draw. You know, an example was the Jillian.
Right.
So we assumed that that would be a huge draw, an expensive event, but the weather and whatever a combination of forces, you know, prevent that from being a very successful, in terms of it was a very successful musical event, but it wasn't a successful, particularly financial event. So you have to, you have these
right.
variations. We know this from the music hall.
Right.
You have something that is a surprise, hugely successful, and generates an extra 10 grand of revenue that compensates for the rainy night or
right.
the odd combination of things or the thing you thought was going to be very successful, what turns out not to be.
But in so any business, after you get used to running a business
you
like
get a
that,
sense
you
of that,
you have your overhead factor, and then you have, you know, in some businesses it might be a business cost factor or a R&D factor that is your weather factor that's hard to. So how do you think about that?
Ben, do you want to respond to that?
It's a complicated, I mean, for us in particular, it's complicated given that what the weather factor. But I think what Jamie was referring to is that the movies in particular, to remove that from the schedule, there's a large revenue loss, but not
yeah.
so much, it's not the same as a concert performer where you're paying the act. There's a small.
I mean, movies, I understand, are your. I mean, I understand that having,
because
we started that at the
music
hall, you can't lose money on movies.
You don't lose money on movies.
No matter what you do. So I understand that stability. And so, you know, maybe you think about these things differently. But I think at some point it would be helpful for us to understand the plug-and-play aspects
yep.
of this from an overhead and revenue perspective, with the weather factor, understanding that you've
yeah.
got to allow
I
for
I think
that.
You have to look at the play as a much more fixed cost operation
yes.
because
yes.
you've got, and that is the bulk of the schedule. But if you just think of, again, the theater, it's the set, you're paying
right.
the actors, you know,
yeah.
in any
That's
case,
clear.
You're paying the
yeah.
musicians, you've got your fixed expenses. And if you lose, you know, three nights of the play because of rain, or you cut one of those, for example, that would be another thing you could cut. The viability of the theater performance is reduced, and then the decision is, do you invest in, you know, the $20,000 in costumes for Little Mermaid to make it, you know, that level of quality
mm-hmm.
that this community has and the visitors have come to expect? Do you, you know, have high school musicians instead of
mm-hmm.
you know professional
mm-hmm.
more professional ones? Do you, you know, whatever, there's this whole sort of level of quality. And honestly, that's something that's been an issue for the festival over the years, when the bad times were there, and you know, and you they did chintz on the play, let me tell you, people you heard about it, you know. So that, so there's very high standards. I mean, we all talk about the festival, just like any of these arts organizations, town Portsmouth has very high standards for the quality of the arts. And if you start going down market
mm-hmm.
and have much less expensive stuff to be save money, you you know, you get into trouble.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to go over a couple of things so that the board that's here today can hear them. You know, I want to start off with the things that we've been able to accomplish with the neighborhood and with Ben. And some of the things that we heard and we're doing from our perspective that are important is that we heard the issue of the idling of the buses that come in for the acts. And the city did put in a system where now the buses can plug into the system. So as of last week, there's been no idling on that. With regards to parking, it's an issue that I think we're going to need to work on with Water Street. It's an issue that doesn't just affect the Arts Festival, but the Gondolo and the Art Association that's down there. So we've got to figure out a way to do that. So we're in the process of talking to it. Our general foreman, Todd Croteau, goes down to the park every single day. He reviews everything that's there. I think some of the residents probably have seen him around, and he has a pretty good relationship. He has a good relationship with Angela. And so whenever there's an issue, we get that right away. So that's been a very positive thing for us. The issue of the financials, we'd really like to get those ASAP, because that's going to relate, you know, as you made your case, I need to look, and I have our controller here for special funds, Judy Renault, as you may know her, and we're going to look at those and take a look at what we see in those and maybe give you some response on that. So those are some of the things that we'd like to see from the board. The other thing is that we have set up, as I've been talking to this for years with Jamie, we finally have set up a special revenue fund for Prescott Park, which means all the costs and revenues are in one area. It's not in the general fund. It's not in the trustees of the trust. And we do receive revenue from the trustees once a year in terms of financing the operations. But that amount of money doesn't cover everything. So we do have a gap there that we know about. It's about $30,000, and we're working on that we need to square that away. The issue of sound, that's something that we're spending. The city council committed to some money to hire a professional to look at that, and David's been working very closely with our person. We've installed the three light system, green, yellow, red. I know that some of the residents aren't happy with some of what's happened, and we're looking into that, but I think there was some good points to a couple of the concerts, so you know, we're getting there. We got to tweak things, so you know, we're looking at that. We're talking to our sound engineer, and we're going to have all the data for every performance that we're going to go over and look at. So those are some of the things that we're doing. The alcohol issue, quite frankly, I think that's been somewhat overblown. But I've been down to almost every concert, and I get up, look around to, you know, to my wife's, you know, chagrin. So I haven't really seen it, but you know, I'm sure it occurs. I mean, we talked to the Attorney General's office. I'm sure you saw that in the paper, and you know, we're not gonna, you know, inspect people's bags, but we have a very vigorous review from the Arts Festival. I see the Arts Festival staff patrolling.
Around. Board members walking
Board
around.
Board members. I mean, we have a lot. If people are drinking, they're doing it
very discreetly.
Very discreetly. So, but it's still, you know, a concern, so we're going to be watching that.
Jim, I'm sorry, but what's the concern with the alcohol? Why are we still making this a big concern? There hasn't been a single incident ever.
There was one the other night.
Well, Michael.
I didn't hear about that one. But my point is not that we should have drink in the park, but that there's so many important things to discuss.
Right.
So much time and energy is being spent on it.
Michael, we got a call from the Attorney General's office, so that's why we're paying attention to that. Terry Knowles.
Before that,
we're doing pretty much what we're doing. I don't want to spend a lot of resources in it. We're not.
Yes.
But we're going to put up some signs. We're going to do what the Attorney General's office has asked us to do. And we're not going to search people's bags. We're not going to smell their solo cup or whatever.
It's just the amount of time spent talking about this when, up until at least recently, there hasn't been a single issue. That's over there.
Welcome to the city of Portsmouth.
So anyways, I know. Even fireworks have its controversy. But I just wanted to go over some of the things that we're working on so the board knows. You know, by and large, we have, we've changed the operation down at the park in terms of the hierarchy within Public Works. So Public Works is doing a lot of support for the park. Michael does his thing, which he should be, on the gardens and in the grounds. And shared space is going fine. I assume that new space is working out okay, Ben?
Yes.
Okay. One thing that we are looking at and we want to talk to you about over the next few months for the next season is emergency access. I just had a meeting with our public safety people, and we need to have more of a robust plan as it relates to emergency access for public safety, and we'll be working with you on that. So those are the things that I have.
Great. Well, I think generally, I mean, my impression is that things have gone really well so far this year, and that I think the, from the festival's perspective, the way that management's working is with your involvement, John, and the staff, the way it's working is good communication. I'm as personally thrilled that it's on phone calls and verbal, and we're trying to respond, and you're responding, and I think we are as well. And I think that there's a lot less of tension, which is useful, because we're all trying to do the best we can to make this thing work. And you know, that balance between a successful festival and a happy community and a good relationship with the city is absolutely vital, and we've got to figure that out. And I think we've made, when you think back to 2 or 3 years ago, I think we should, you know, it's easy to beat ourselves up, but we have made huge progress. So that said, I know, with the interest of time, I think we should perhaps go through the specific things in this document, just to.
Yeah, I just, John mentioned parking at the beginning, and I just wondered if you could be more specific about what the issue is and what we're trying to solve. I mean, what we expect, sure, and what the issue is. Just.
Well, the issue is the unregulated access to the parking. So really, it becomes unregulated with the gate system we have today.
You mean Water Street in particular?
Water Street, yes.
They have had somebody there often, right, who's right. Supposed to. I mean, I've seen him.
Sure, but the thing is, that might. Are you talking about Strawberry Bank? Or are you talking about?
No.
Okay.
No. Haven't
but
you
that
had
might
somebody
be for the
there monitoring. Oh,
it's been very. The Art Association.
Yeah, we're going to be talking, and we need to. What we're looking at, we looked at the idea of a mechanical gate. I talked to the Public Works and our new parking manager, and that just wouldn't work. We don't have enough space, really, to do it right. So what we're going to look at, and we'll talk to all three users of the park, a permit system, and that might be the best way to deal with it, because you know who should be parking there, and the Arts Festival, I mean, the Gundala will know, and the... Arts Association. So we're going to look at a permit system,
okay,
and I think we'll take care of that. With regards to the parking itself, I think Strawberry Bank, with their parking, has helped augment the island. Of course, has caused a little bit of a problem, but people have, I think, managed and figured out where to go. They park, quite frankly, they park up here at City Hall and walk down.
Okay.
So that's the only other thing I would have to say, this will be it. I want to just direct this at the residents, because I know they've been patient about things, and I get their feedback on a regular basis. The sound is going to, you know, I think we've made a lot of strides in a lot of areas. The sound is going to be one we're going to have to tweak. We have a professional sound person. It's not always going to be perfect, but I think you would agree we're working at it on every single occasion. We are taking readings off the site. So, I mean, we'll have at the end of the year a full review of how the sound is for each concert, and so I just wanted to let you know that I think everything else has been addressed. The sound is, of course, still the wild card that we as a staff are working on. So I just wanted to say that. Thank you.
And we know that just like the grass conditions and everything else are also weather dependent. Mm-hmm. I know from my location that, you know, fog, wind, humidity, we know that the impacts that can have on sound and where it ends up in different places at different times in different ways. So so we'll go through this, these just specific points, and just make comments. And
I think there was a lot of great information shared at the outset related to the financial characteristics of the types of performances. We understand the movie thing a little bit more now. We understand the play thing. I think it's intuitive that would be a fixed and predictable cost from year to year. But we didn't really get the same characteristic of the concert situation. So can you draw that picture for us about what the variables are there that affect the overall operation?
So I'll maybe let Ben go into the drill down on that. The concert variables and the I mean, obviously, a successful concert on a beautiful night with it's not just the revenue from the donations. So the gate donations do represent 25% of the revenue, Sponsorships represent about another 25% of the revenue. So the moving pieces, the sponsorships are key in terms of the total program. The particularly the major sponsors, the downtown merchants and restaurants, they're obviously interested in the larger events. They're interested in the success of the festival as a whole. They're not giving to specific events. They're giving to the sponsorship of the series. So there, if you start reducing the quality or the number dramatically, the sponsors will say, well, what's my value? What's my value per, if I'm giving $20,000 to underwrite this series, I'm expecting X number of benefits of the, as Joel just said, of particularly the nights. I mean, that was one of the reasons that the concerts were on the Wednesday nights. There are two main reasons there that are important, and Ben can add, and I'm no expert on this at all, but one is you get good people on those weeknights. You get the top names. You couldn't afford to get some of these people on a Saturday or a Friday night. They're going to be playing in Boston or Meadowbrook or Portland or some much bigger venue where they can get paid a great deal more, where they're not outside. That's certainly an issue, and the uncertainty of, I think Ben tries to have three or four or five headliners who will bring in a good crowd and be the anchors to the programming, and then it allows some of the less, just like we have at the music hall, you have less well-known, newer things that are maybe a little bit edgier in terms of not being known by people, or newer groups. You get them for less money. They may only attract a few hundred people. The other ones help cover the average costs. So you're better programming, you're successful programming. The big unknown, of course, is if you get one of those headliners that ends up in the North Church, like happened, you know, suddenly what could have been a substantial financial benefit to the program becomes a loss, even though you put on the event, because you only get 300-400 people into the North Church. So that becomes, and you're still paying the performer. So you still have all your costs. Ben, do you want to add some more?
Yeah, I just wanted to add the membership factor as well, which is primarily made up of Portsmouth residents and General Seacoast residents who are season members, and season members are generally concert goers. So the lineup really drives that, and the membership makes up more than 10% of our operating budgets. And it makes sense when you think about it, because you'll go see the musical once, twice, maybe three times, but you will go, if you love music or a gathering or are looking for something to do, you'll go to many concerts, which your membership, season membership, would make sense. So that's the big driver there. Also, table revenue is another big one coming from concerts, which also makes up more than 10% of our operating budget.
Just to be clear, it's over 10% for memberships and over 10% for tables?
Yes.
The tables drive as much revenue as
yes.
the memberships do? And you think that what percent of both of those is driven by the concerts, just at your gut, because you can't know 100%, right?
75%.
Over 20% is driven
sense.
By the concerts.
Just when you're talking, just bring the microphone closer to you, because this is being broadcast live. So.
Okay, so does that help you with that? And we'll provide the moving parts in a Excel spreadsheet for you, so you can understand the various different components of it. To see, and I think we can walk through, which we've done before, those various different moving parts. It's not an easy business to run. I mean, I actually think having observed this one pretty closely over time, and also been involved with several other arts organizations in the community, this one is the most variable moving parts. It's the most unpredictable, because both the crowd, the revenue from that particular audience, and the weather are all factors that you just don't have, and you're much more dependent. Then the music hall isn't particularly dependent on its concession stand, or the extras that are bought, the merchandise, or the where a very successful arts festival summer it relates to good revenue from the food concession. That's hugely important. If you're, you know, only generating 25% of your revenue from people making donations to attend the programming, so that's a challenge. And you've got also corporate sponsorship is the primary source of revenue. The music hall and other arts organizations in this community are way more dependent on individual donations and individual philanthropy. And the festival, we've started this this year, the People for the Park, which is a small group of larger donors, individuals, the generous arts patrons that are, you look at the list, you know, it's Joe Lampreys and Bobby Sweets and other people like that have been very, very generous to our community. And they are making a statement that they believe that a stakeholder type things to the arts is for this programming is very important. And we have about 15 or so of those people giving, you know, a few thousand dollars a year to support it, make a statement. But other than that, individual philanthropy is just the memberships. Mm. It's not the way, you know, the music hall has 50 stakeholders. This is a substantial driver to underwrite programming. So we'll go through these. Ben, do you want to? I think that the season start and end dates has pretty much been agreed on, and it's we've followed that for the last few years. I don't think it's we agreed a few years ago that we would not have anything before but, you know, the school nights on you know, except for on the weekends. Did Ben, do you want to make any comment on that one?
On the very all three points.
Well, just on the season start and end.
Nope.
The only comment I would have, I might, that we're going to have to look at next year. I would try to avoid in the first part of this. I know this was because of scheduling. We had three concerts in the first week, so I would really like you to try to avoid that. I know you said you called me, you talked to me about it, and I didn't quite get it, you know, when I was talking to you, because then when I lived it, you know, the three nights, it was a little, you know, it had some intensity to it the start of the season. So I think we need to pay attention to that. I know that sometimes because of who's available, who's not available, but I'd really like it, even though it might not be a school night, but it really got us off I know you told us, but I didn't realize, you know, the intensity of it.
Yeah, I think I wouldn't disagree with that. I think it was a really difficult decision. This is this fine line of, you know, when you get it, suddenly there's a person that's fantastic that you've been trying to book forever, and they're only available X. Right. And what do you do? And that's this flexibility. And so that's a very tricky one, but I think that's a spirit. I think if we were regulated on when to have what, when, and how, that would probably kill the festival. If you were said we can only have concerts on Wednesday nights, that would be really disastrous for the festival, because, you know, you might need to have 2 1 week and none the next week. So that's you've got to have some sort of flexibility there. The Labor Day weekend, traditionally we have gone to the following weekend. This year we have Swan Lake and the Portsmouth Symphony on the weekend after Labor Day. That's, you know, that's been the last multiple years. Does allow us to, it's a really good time of year, and it's those that Friday and Saturday night after Labor Day. I think would like to be able to still keep that mm-hmm. flexibility if something came up that was good.
Before we leave this notion of schedule, I know it's not here, but it's come up in the conversations here, and it came up during the master planning as a trade-off for maybe some less intensity during the week. Would there be interest viability in some programming on weekends into the fall? That was one of the things we talked about last time. Is that a viable thing to think about? And we talked about that for a couple reasons. First of all, that the challenge of the festival for the neighborhood is intensity, like we just said, you know, three heavy nights in a row when you've got people flooding into your neighborhood, as well as the weather shift. You know, often we get our best weather in September and October. I know it gets a little cool in the evening, but certainly during the master planning process, when people were concerned about whether a stage would be up and how long the stage would be up, there was interest expressed in people programming during some of those times, and whether it's a daytime performance or another. Would there be interest in that, or does that take, like you're mobilizing for a construction, does that take a mobilization issue that makes these things too challenging and too costly? Any thoughts on that?
And I'll let you respond.
No commitments, but just thoughts on that.
I think it would definitely be interesting to explore. We would have the challenge, a couple challenges, of staffing. The majority of our people are going back to school or their regular jobs. And also, there's the attendance factor, the mindset of summer and looking for activities to do with your kids, where then you're back at school and you're back at work and you're back in a routine versus the summer schedule of like a Monday night movie. It's Monday night, and yet the park is filled with families, unlike, you know, the fall Monday night would, you know, be really tough.
Yeah, and I wouldn't think anything about weekends once you're back, you know, you're further on and there are people in town, and, you know, it has some characteristics of a summer. But the thought of both reducing some of the intensity, but also, you know, I know you've talked about things that are more for Portsmouth residents. I think things that might be in September might have that feeling.
Yeah, we'd be very interested to explore that. We did explore it probably 5 years ago, and we did a couple concerts in September and October, and we were challenged to get people to come again because that mindset shift, but also the weather, it gets
starts to get
cooler once the sun goes down, which was tough.
So a night concert might be a challenge.
We also need to be careful because Strawberry Bank and some other places have fall events. You know, there's that wine one, the beer one, the film festival, and those are all busy in the fall.
So I would think, subject to further discussion, but
we would certainly
like the flexibility of going to at least to the weekend after Labor Day to keep maintain that. This next one. No events after 7 p.m. on a night before a school day. Ben, I didn't understand whether that, I don't think that's happened.
Where are we?
C.
Well, currently there's, on a school day, school nights, we've had the internal, or working with the city, of a curfew of 9 o'clock.
But when is that actually applied?
It's Sunday night, probably.
Yeah, and we actually don't have any this season. We've stayed away from
that. Well, this year, there was one on the 18th of June, Sunday night, and the 21st of June.
But those were scheduled before snow days. I mean, that's an issue.
Snow days in New Hampshire.
Snow days in New Hampshire, right. Which
a school calendar that's set the previous fall.
So, and we book up those events in March or something like that without knowing when those things are. Mm-hmm. So I think sensitivity on the early end of the season is a fair point. And I think that's well taken. And Ben, we can do that, concentrate on that. And maybe we put a little bit more into the later part of the season. I mean, that's worth talking about. Number D there is the schedule. Our current season is the 12 weeks, and it's been that way for some time. And we're talking, you know, what Chris just brought up. Let's talk further about the options there as we get down into the. We've had a pretty good conversation about the limiting the, the dark nights. I think the grass issue, I'd just like to address a little bit. I do believe that weather and maintenance are a big factor here, as well as the use. And we know last year, everybody's lawns in Portsmouth were dead because we stopped watering. But there was also some issues with maintenance, and I do think that if you look at the pictures that we can provide of multiple different seasons over the last few years, you go back to 11 and 10 and other years, there was, you know, worse grass conditions at the end of the year than there were now. But it's certainly an area that we, you know, I think we can all work together to figure out. I think, John, we worked on getting the blankets not going down too early. That's way more impacting, yeah, those of us who are gardeners. That has way more impact, anything that prevents that, you know, that creates the heat on the lawn on a hot, yeah, day is going to kill it way more than people sitting on it.
Yeah, and our general foreman is looking at that, and so he's overseeing that. So
and I think you can, you know, obviously that you go down there now this year with the weather we've had and the other efforts that we've made, I think it's less of an issue than it was last year.
And just to Mr. Chairman, this dark night concept and talking about the grass is one aspect of the impact or the intensity of the events that the committee has talked about, and we've also talked about there's cost to the intensity of events, which is related to the condition of the park, which you've addressed through grass, but there's at least two others, which is related to the public's experience of the park as a park. There's cost to that, as well as, and we're learning this more and more with the sound issue. Sound is, and sound exposure is linked to schedule. And we're finding that the amount of sound is not just about decibels. The amount of sound is how long you hear it, how often. And we're learning how the linkage of that as well. So there's really three aspects of the dark nights issue associated with the condition of the park, which I agree is being actively managed, as well as the what the landscape architects and the master plan costs described as the social impact in terms of the use of the park as a park, the experience in the park. And then there's the issue associated with sound and exposure over time. So I just wanted to remind the committee of the breadth of the issues associated with the schedule on that
one. Yep. I could just add to, I think those are two important things, but just to keep in mind that the second dark night that would happen would be the movie, which has to take place when it's dark and dusk. So that social use aspect, that's generally when the park is closed or is closed to the general public.
Mm-hmm. So right. You're basically. Sorry.
And it's also our shortest event in terms of sound, and there's never been a complaint in terms of the...
Well, I got some on this one.
You did?
Star Wars must have been very loud, because I got a bunch of complaints on my phone.
There you go.
Yeah.
Oh, Star Wars was loud.
Yeah, well, the other, to add to David's list, which I think is helpful to think about, is sort of the rhythm of these things. That's what I mainly got related to the consultants. It's like how much is, you know, like you were just saying, three big ones in a row versus one big one, two little ones, another big one. So there's also the variability.
And having the play and then a concert, I think it's intensity. I think that's one of the things, you know, even though the play may not be, you know, overbearing, it's still there in the background. So having a concert, having the play in one day, you got that.
Right. Mm-hmm. You got a longer period of time. And I think, you know, we talk about the play, you know, there's been resistance to reducing the number of play performances in the community.
I think we should reduce the number.
You think we should reduce?
Should not. I think that's an important part.
So you start doing that, and if you take the financial viability of the concerts as the play, let's say the play breaks even or loses money, so that it's being underwritten by other activities of the festival, and you eliminate the movies, which are low cost, a very low cost, and provide some revenue and sponsorship that's a nice, you know, percentage. And
but that's a choice. We went right to the movies in terms of what would be canceled. But that's a policy decision of the board.
Because it's, you know,
it's also your most predictably cost beneficial event.
Yeah.
So that's where the committee has trouble on driving the information about the how the different events work together.
Yeah.
We understand it's a pretty complex algorithm.
Right.
You seem to indicate your only choice on dark nights is one particular offering, and
well, it could
I
be
think
a
the
play
committee
on,
is talking
could be eliminating
about
a play. You could eliminate a play night.
But that's an inaccurate statement to say that the movies are the most profitable aspect of the festival.
No, they're not the most profitable at all. They're in terms of
most consistent.
Most consistently in the
predictable.
Black.
Predictable.
There, it, when there's good weather.
Right, Michael, you were next.
Well, just on the, I would like to hear from the Arts Festival maybe if they're inside. I live right across the street, and the skating rink, when it's closed during the wintertime, our parking lot ends up being a nice place to make illegal transactions and such, right? And we've lived there for 15 years now, but you see it. And, you know, when we walk through the park and in that part of town when there's no activities going on, it's very dark, there's not a lot of street lights, and my wife doesn't feel safe walking at night with the dog. I go out with her, which is fine in the summertime when it's cold out, it's more of a problem for me. But my question, I'm wondering, you know, we're talking about dark night, but you know, honestly, when the park is dark, it feels a lot less safe to me as a resident of the neighborhood. I was wondering if you had any experience over the years with that being a factor we should be thinking about.
Definitely, I mean, it comes and goes where we've encountered extreme to minor vandalism on the facilities, but also on a nightly basis when we're there cleaning up, you can see the people, our audience leaves very quickly, and then as we're cleaning up, you'll see the other audience coming into the park. But it's not there when we're in session.
Jen?
I was just going to mention that just one other impact thing that I've been walking around, like, during the shows, walking around the neighborhood, and I have to say, actually, the noise has not been a factor as far as I could tell, but what I have heard people complaining about, and not even complaining, because most of them say this is the fact, but that it's, even after any event at the park, there's like nobody's doing anything appropriate, but you know, talking about what a great show that was, but you know, it's a small neighborhood and they're talking about it at the top of their lungs and it's 11 o'clock at night. But the biggest issue too is just the parking within the neighborhoods themselves, and that especially I know parking in the South End is I never realized how lucky I was to not live in the South End in terms of parking. But I just think when you were talking about the three things, that's just another impact thing.
Sure.
To put on the table, that's all.
I think that's great to bring up again, because I'm also a resident and in the South End and have been for my almost 40 years, and it is an issue, and it can be an event that's going on somewhere else as well. I mean,
yeah.
You get a Strawberry Bank event, it's always, of course, ironic to me when something is going on there that people are calling, assuming it was a Prescott Park event, with the noise, and that there's other organizations in the community that have events that create, that add to this intensity feeling. It's not just the park, it's all other different things that are happening. But, and Chris, you and I have talked about this, about alternatives and being more aggressive and about the parking issue. And I say to people when they say, I say park at City Hall, park at Little Harbor School, and walk. You know, it's not that hard.
They are doing that, James.
And I think they are doing
it.
And I just think I think we can be increasingly creative, and maybe next year we should do some trials with a shuttle bus or something like that. I don't know, to try and pull the parking away from the South End.
Yeah, I know, but then again, that we've tried a lot of different things.
I know you.
People don't. People like their car, but anyways.
I know.
We'll talk about that more.
I know, and we tried with the bicycles. We've done. You know, we've tried all sorts of different things. And you know,
sure.
It's.
No, we understand that.
It's a. You know, and anyway, we will do whatever we the festival, and I'm sure that other organizations involved will do whatever they can to help this issue. We certainly tried with our website and other things to encourage people
right.
Different places.
I just have a comment question about the dark nights, to get it all straight. So Monday night is movie night.
Right.
Tuesday night is a dark night. Wednesday night is a concert. And then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday about is the play. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah, so sometimes there's concerts dropped in other dates. There's sometimes a concert on a Saturday and a play.
Instead of the play.
Play. And sometimes there's been a concert, rarely there's been a concert on a Tuesday and another dark night
okay.
During the week. So there's some flexibility within that.
Does the play on the weekends run on Saturdays, like in the afternoon and the evening? Is there a double?
It's generally, if there's a concert, there'll be a matinee.
Okay.
We try to offer around 4 to 8 matinees a season. You know, we never seem to can satisfy there being enough matinees or there being too many matinees, so we try to offer somewhere in that range.
And the Sunday night starts earlier, so it's an earlier finish for
younger
kids.
And Thursday night as well,
kids.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, just trying to get a clear picture, so if we do ask for another dark night, what that would mean.
Chris?
So far we've talked about this only from a financial standpoint. You know, that if we change the amount of programming, it would have a financial effect. And I can buy part of that, but I'd need to know more about the inputs and the outputs before I buy the whole thing. But imagine for a minute we were in a different community, like in a city. The city would be paying for programming, right? In most places in the world, you would expect that you'd have an arts department within the city that would put a certain amount of money into its parks for programming. I mean, that happens all over our country. And so imagine if that were to be true. Would you still be as wedded? I mean, it's not like we're a community that doesn't have anything else going on, that if people wanted to attend something else in the evening, they should be able to find something else. It's not like we'd be depriving of any arts activity if we were rebalancing that a little. Is it strictly a financial thing that you're looking at?
I would...
Ben, you want to use the microphone because we have a couple times.
I would... say that the financial aspect is certainly considerable, but is definitely not the only issue. And you can see that every night in the park, and every audience is different. The movie nights are very much Portsmouth residents. I had someone comment on Monday night how interesting they thought it was of the streets, people walking with pillows on their way down to the park. With the park being filled with people wanting, you know, it's what they want. I mean, they wouldn't be coming if they didn't want it. So I think there are a lot of things to do. We're very blessed with having lots to do in this great city. But I think there's that love factor and enjoyment and quality, safe, accessible for everybody, that you can go and not spend a dime, the same as your neighbor. Regardless of your means, I think that's a really important factor on top of the financial side of things.
I think we do want to reemphasize, maybe we haven't done that enough, of where the festival came from and the mission of accessibility. And, you know, you got to go back and think about, sure, we have a lot more options now, but, you know, and without naming any, but there are, it's very expensive even in Portsmouth now to go to arts events. And, you know, it's increasingly so. And the top tickets at venues are getting up toward not Boston prices. There's still a deal compared to Boston or whatever, but it's expensive. And I do think that when I look back at the families that have said to me over the years that their children's first exposure to live performance was Prescott Park, whether it was a concert, whether it was the play, the community and the quality events that people are able to be exposed to for a relatively small amount of money. That is, let alone the visitors that can't believe it. I mean, I was down there, and hearing people from out of region or out of country, and they just can't even imagine that they could go to something internationally known performer and make an $8 donation. Or not give anything if they don't have anything in their pocket. And if you think about that in Portsmouth, a viable festival, that is a pretty extraordinary thing. It sends a message about our community and who we are and what we have been for a long time. And, you know, Jen, you've been here, and Chris, you've been a long time. We've all worked incredibly hard to build the arts community as this what this community is, and I think we're all really proud of that. So the overall is the financial viability of the festival. There's no subsidy from the downtown merchants and sponsors and the donations that make the festival work. And if you start, you know, being restrictive of the flexibility of a Ben's opportunity to get some nationally known folk performer on a, you know, Thursday night.
Don't go to extremes, no.
What?
No, there's no need for you to jump to an extreme.
Right, no, no.
We expect that
but,
from others.
But it does, no, I don't mean to be extreme. But I think we do need some flexibility. And I think the best message that I've heard out of this conversation, which I think Ben needs to be really sensitive to, is the intensity of impact. How can we schedule it without regulatory environment in a manner that spreads the events out in a way that feels more comfortable?
So that actually brings a question that's been percolating in my mind as I've listened to the conversation, and that is that in terms of flexibility, at an earlier one of our meetings, I think it was Chris, somebody suggested that perhaps, and we'll use the movies as an example, that they could be put on at another site, like South Mill Playground or someplace else in the city on that Monday night. I'd like to hear your comment on that.
Or that we could even, as we're developing public spaces, create another space mm-hmm. with the amenities that would make that feasible.
Could I just jump on that before you answer the question? Because one of the things that I've been thinking about, you know, I've been here for a long time, from the very beginning, I remember the very first show, is that because I think the trustees actually started the festival and the park have just become so co-branded. I mean, we all, even right now, when we say Prescott Park, are we talking about the place or are we talking about the festival? And I think that's part of the issue that is we're all kind of trying to tease apart. So I think when that question came up, what reminded me of it was this winter, you all did John's here, we did the 30 pages in 30 days, this playwriting festival. And we did, some of it was done at Seacoast Rep, some of it was at West, some of it was at UNH. And frankly, up until that point, I'd never actually thought of the festival as being a separate entity. And it was very exciting to think, well, this is an entity that exists beyond just the park. And so I'm just wondering if you all have thought about that or what, I mean, it's a way of growing, but outside the boundaries of the park, which is in some ways a small venue. I'm just curious. I think that was part of our reasoning for throwing that out there. So,
Ben, you want to respond to
well,
that?
Well, the movies, I would just, you know, that the movies can take place anywhere, but there's obvious infrastructure involved that is necessary, and like the investment into the prop, the food concessions. You need the projector, you need the speakers, you need lights, you need a screen. But sure, I mean, that could take place anywhere.
Would you be willing to develop a financial model on what it would cost if the Arts Festival put that on somewhere else?
Sure.
That'd be great. I think that would be helpful.
We had some creative ideas about how you might do that, some fun things that we've brainstormed around, and, you know, a movie appropriate to an unusual location. I do think you have to recognize that the family that loves to. I mean, we can all go on that and have some good laughs about what you do or whatever. You know, airport at on the Pease runway or whatever it was. But I do think you have to also recognize what you just said is there's an emotional, you know, the physical location is really special.
Yeah.
And, you know, that does make a difference when your grandmother's in town and you bring the kids and you sit on the and have your picnic and watch a movie. Where do you want to do that? And it's worth putting some more energy in. As far as the other location thing, I'm also excited about this. And we did the Christmas Carol in Exeter, utilizing the talent. We have to recognize that Portsmouth is our center, but that our community is broader. A large number of donors, supporters, sponsors come from the neighboring towns. Lots of people that, you know, work in Portsmouth, live in other communities around here. And to have an organization like other, you know, we all do with all the other arts organizations, that it's a 100,000 population community, really, and Portsmouth is the center of it. So I think it's very appropriate to have, and plus, you know, the linkages and the partnerships that come out of something like the playwriting thing, which were huge and great success.
Chris?
Well, I think it would be very helpful to us as we're thinking about developing some of the other public spaces, to have you guys also be thinking about how this could work. So the Bridge Vaughan Worth potential for a park, what amenities would need to be there in order to do viable programming there? The new public space at the new garage, what amenities would need to be there? What configuration would help? The new park that will be by 3S, is there some synergy there? If you haven't been on the top of the McIntyre building, I'll tell you, you know, it's a dream for thinking about what programming would be like up there as we're looking at that. So to be getting some input into some of the other public spaces, because we have to design those with that in mind. They're not just big space. We have to design it with performance in mind or movies in mind and what amenities need to be there. So I think that would be great modeling help and input, because we're on the cusp of all of these interesting places.
So Jamie, we got about 15 minutes.
Yeah,
left.
And I need to.
And so
I need to exit.
If
myself.
You could.
Okay, so
highlight which ones in here you.
We are. Where are we?
Concern.
We talked about the. We think we have a generic conversation about the performance days, and we would say honestly that we do have some great concerns about restricting the number of days, cutting it back. I think that's the general response that you would expect from us, but we need to give you a stronger financial model and give you some variabilities.
Frequency is an issue for, you know, that we really have to get to. I mean, again, I don't want to beat this horse, but
yeah,
that intensity at the beginning of the season was really was not the best that we could have done.
But I
understand what happened, but
yeah, it was not planned deliberately to be
that
way.
No, I understand
way.
That. Ben communicated with me.
It happened, and I agree, and it wouldn't have been my choice at all. I do think we have to recognize that on the noise and the energy, you know, we tried to. I think there was the real problems about the play with Shrek, which was 3 years ago, and that was the play rather than concerts that created the most disturbance that particular year, and that it was multiple nights in the same week, and you know you heard that music 4 times in a row, and you aren't real excited about it. I wasn't myself, but. So I think, you know, that's an issue too. You've got to be very, very sensitive, and there's not so many, you know, picking the right play that provides something to all age groups, you know, that the kids and the grandparents can go to happily, and is, you know, appropriate, space appropriate. You know, there's only so many Mary Poppins and Little Mermaids, and, you know, we'll see. Hopefully we can continue to find that. And keeping those quality, that's a big part of this that I think people, in terms of the cost, the percentage of cost, what would you say, Ben, of the actual overhead of the play as a percentage of the total overhead of the organization, of the
I wouldn't know offhand.
Yeah, so we'll provide you some information breaking down some of those things. So where else do you, let's see here. We've talked about the maximum number of events per season. I mean, I think that we've been pretty consistent in the maximum total. I think the message that we're talking about here isn't the total, it's the how they're spread. So it's the concentration of events, and I think that's something that we can really work toward.
How about one of the proposals in E, which is the maximum hours per weekend day? So there are some times in which the programming starts at 11 and goes to 10 o'clock at night.
Ben, you want to?
Yeah, well, those instances are where you have a matinee and then you'll have an evening performance. So, I mean, the challenge there would be doing away with the matinee or one of the community showcases, which are generally
prior to, you know, late afternoon prior to the evening performance, which are local groups that we offer the stage free of charge of dance troops, PMAC, various things like that. So, I mean, it's a delicate balance of, you know, we get complaints or requests saying there's not enough matinees, there's too many matinees, the matinee doesn't start early enough, it starts too late, or same with the evening.
But there still could be a maximum. It doesn't say what the maximum is. Sure. There still could be a...
And those matinees are primarily 1 o'clock starts,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So the 11 o'clock events are examples such as the cast meet and greet. What are their 11 o'clock starts?
I think that's the only thing. And the meet and greets are an isolated...
Sunday at 10 o'clock.
Are isolated events that, it's limited participation and limited area of the park. It's not a show per se. It's a kids gathering.
Right.
Not, it's not a performance.
Okay. Go ahead, Jamie.
So, you can eliminate matinees of the play. But is that you got to balance that with community needs. So you can't eliminate, if you start eliminating Saturday events in the evening, that has a dramatic financial impact.
Right. The other types of events this year are 10 a.m. on Saturday, Sunday, camp shows for 2 weekends. So that's, yep. That's performance-related things.
So that's our youth
right.
Theater camp,
right.
Which...
trying to get the full breadth,
sure.
So people are aware of the vocabulary of events.
So our theater camp is kids ranging from ages 8 to 17 who learn a musical, build props, costumes, and then present the musical on the main stage as part of the festival experience. It is a performance. It's limited in capacity. It's the parents, the grandparents, and people coming to see this.
Is there flexibility in the start time for that?
Sure. It's really just trying to figure out where it fits mm-hmm. in the calendar without mm-hmm. interfering with the main offerings.
So we have this, you guys are offering fantastic free art and entertainment right to community, right? And it's 100% free. So we understand that. And that I think we're balancing that with the impact on the community. You know, I'm just trying to like write this. That you guys are offering this great free service to the community, and the community doesn't like that it's too impactful on the neighborhood. And then you guys keep bringing up if we want to cut back the number of days, which I mentioned how I like when there's life in the neighborhood, but cut back to it, it's going to be a financial impact. But what is that financial impact? Like we haven't actually discussed it. It's really starting to bother me. There's an amount of money it costs to run that organization for the year. You could divide it by the number of concerts. So it's $1 million a year to run it. It's 100 events, then it's $10,000 per event, right? That's the profit needs to be generated. I know, it doesn't work that way.
Right.
So to Chris's point, does the city say, well, fine, we believe in this event, this organization, do we pay, we want you to cut down the number of nights by 10 nights, and we're gonna pay you $100,000, right? And we're talking
sure,
around
exactly.
this, but can't we just have that conversation? Not
exactly.
today.
No,
but I'd like to, like, so if you guys could come back at some point, we get information about how much it really costs per night. I know you can't do that, but you need to. And have a conversation about it. Is it worth $10,000 a night to have it quiet? I think it's quite honestly not, but that's just my opinion. But this is
the other thing is would be, you know, you would be mm-hmm. dealing with a situation where it wouldn't fit into the arts festival, because every year, you have different council members sometimes, different priorities. So in 1 year, you get it all cut out. Next
well,
year, you can have it. But
that's why we're doing a long-term agreement.
Right. But my point is that we do already provide, a stage and everything. But, I'm open to anything. I mean, clearly, there are, would the programming that you provide be the ones that we provide if we're paying for it? I don't know, probably not, but we look at some different things. Not to be disrespectful or anything, but we'd be looking at different kinds of entertainment.
Well, the city might decide to underwrite the play, for example.
Well, again, it would be up to the city council to make
yeah.
that determination.
I mean, that's a very common kind of
yeah, I
urban, thing to do. I think it's really worth talking about because, you know, you can argue that people need it every night. Yeah, they don't need it every night. You know that. And they do, the idea of offering free entertainment is a fabulous thing. Do I need it every night? Do I need ice cream every night? No. So, you know, that argument's not going to go that far.
Right.
The financial argument, I think, is a real one, and that's why we're trying to figure out the parameters behind it. There might even be some insights that some of us could provide about costing and modeling things. But I think, I agree with Michael. I think we should be talking about that because we're hearing from merchants. They're making a lot of money off of this. People are coming into our community. People are parking. People are seeing our community. We have, if it truly is a community service, then it's something that we contribute to.
The other thing is, would it be at Prescott Park? Where would we run it? Would we run it through our park department? We'd have to have full access to all financials, you know, and make sure that, because people will be asking that during the budget time.
Sure,
so there's
sure,
a
sure.
lot of things.
There are trade-offs, yeah.
No,
yeah.
And yeah, although the city does give grants to other other nonprofit organizations right. for services.
Yeah, we spend sure. about, I don't know, $300,000 in the budget.
Total for social services.
Sure.
Yeah, so, you know, and not only that, but what goes into the operations of the overhead you have is very limited in terms of physical overhead, you know, because you don't have to worry about that, like, you know, the music hall would have to worry about that.
But their season is also very short. The music hall has the opportunity to have programming all year round. So
I mean, it all goes down to what you want to put on the tax rate. I mean, people are upset because we accepted money for the fireworks, when, you know.
So, right.
You know, I saved $400,000. They're upset. What do you do?
They're upset about the bicycles.
And don't like the bicycles?
Well, that thing,
because they take up parking spaces.
That's because somebody bought right. a monthly pass.
Right.
Oh, my Lord. Okay.
So anyway. So people are going to be upset. We'll take that for granted. But
whatever you do, whatever we talk about, I appreciate it being brought up because it is an interesting conversation to have. And I think I hope this has to be the start of, you know, this conversation, knowing that the time is running out and I have to be somewhere else as well, as I'm sure all the rest of you do. On the audience intensity, on the numbers of people, it's unbelievably impossible to tell. I mean, our prediction was Jillian Welch would be the biggest event of the season or whatever, or one of them, and it wasn't. You know, whether it was the weather, whether it was, you know, some people, you know, who knows? It's very. And we had no prediction that Iron and Wine would be as huge an event as it was. I mean, that was not expected at all. So it's a very, very difficult thing to predict an audience size. And, you know, the best known is Mary Chapin Carpenter draw, you know, a different older crowd perhaps and a younger. I mean, it's just, I don't know. It's very, very difficult. And you know, how would you possibly, you know, do that? I mean, I open that up to you. How would we subtly say, sorry, there's no more people allowed in Prescott Park?
It just doesn't
work. What that really would deal with is this. What I was getting at earlier, and I'll just make this quick, is on the public safety and access for right. emergency vehicles, certain things have to be enforced. The walkways, which get filled in during the concerts, have to be enforced. The way into the park has to be enforced because we saw there were emergencies, and you know you have to get there. So we're going to work on that plan with Ben, and we're going to take a look at the. You know, we'll bring our public safety people in, and we might bring somebody from the outside to take a look. So, you know, it's something for next year. But we also, I think, you numbered the gates, which is helpful. So that we can tell the fire department if there's an ambulance call, it's gate one, gate two, that type of thing.
Yeah, and I think we have had a few medical issues this year that have happened, and they've been all done.
And what's been very helpful is the gate numbers, because that's where the ambulance will go.
So we have that.
But let me posit that if you can't even begin to estimate a big versus a small, how do you negotiate fees? I mean, obviously, if you're budgeting at all, if you're thinking of negotiating at all, you have a broad sense. That doesn't mean you're always correct. I get that point. But you have a broad sense of, because, you know, you're trying to do the rhythm of different kinds of events. So all this is saying is having a very broad sense of, you know, five really big headliners a year instead of 10. Now, maybe one of those people is a dud and people don't come out to it, fine. But, I mean, obviously, in budgeting and negotiating fees, you have some sense of that.
We do.
You're not doing it blind. I know that.
But some of the same acts from year to year, too. So, yeah. Yes, the rain could come.
You have a sense. You have a sense of those.
You have a sense.
But, Chris, the big thing that is that only 25% of the revenues are from the donations, are from the gate.
I understand that. We're not talking here about revenue. We're talking about intensity.
Oh, intensity.
So,
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I understand that. But you also take into account when you've had a repeat act. I mean,
you do
that.
You certainly do. Ben, do you want to respond to that?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, I think if you take a look at our offering, it's very diverse. I mean, one of the things I find very fascinating is that I have different people approach me saying that this show is going to be the biggest show ever. I'm so excited. And it's, you know, it's because that's of that demographic. And then I'll have someone else from who's 10 years younger.
But you have you personally, Ben, have a broader understanding of that. And so when you're understanding that, you've got to do that. You're not doing it blind. You've got all this experience to tell you.
He does.
But that's looking at, that's saying, okay, Iron and Wine is going to appeal to the 30-somethings, and then my Mary Chapin Carpenter is going to appeal to the north of 50.
Right.
And so now I need something for in the 40s.
That's right.
But it's not looking, saying, okay, this is going to pull in 10,000 people.
No, but when you have a Mary Chapin Carpenter, you know whether that's a big or a small. That's all I'm saying. If you don't.
Partly because of how much they cost.
Oh, how much they cost. I mean, you're working with a budget.
Too.
Sure. But I mean, you have a broad sense at the outset of the season. I'm not talking about predicting every night.
Right.
I'm talking about the broad season.
I think there's
season.
A general
You'd
broad
have
sense.
To have that.
Yeah.
Otherwise...
Totally.
I'll
Absolutely. Or you know, I mean, that's what he the job that he does
of
is
course.
To figure that out.
How big is tonight, Ben?
It's a gorgeous night.
I mean, it's the difference between.
He's relatively unknown, yeah. So. But I think we'll have a good crowd.
Yeah.
Right.
But I cannot tell you, I have not heard anyone talking about this one coming up tonight, so
right.
I would say it's going to be a smaller crowd just from what I'm
right.
hearing from that 30 and under crowd.
Right.
Whereas when I heard Lake Street Dive, the first one, I had never heard
the guy
of
from
right, but I trust
heard,
Ben
I
as the
Northern,
expert.
He's from
on this,
Bangor,
not you, Ken.
Northern Ireland. My friends forever fellow that's staying at my house, his dad taught him at school in Bangor. It's so,
right.
But I don't think he's well known here. But
he's got a mean accent with a Irish touch.
Let's see if we can wrap this up, David.
Yeah. I don't see where we anything else that we need to deal with. The performance times the only thing that's in there that you're missing is the if we have the movies, you're saying, you know, Sunday through Thursday, the movies obviously start at dark and end, so you can't have a movie in June or July that ends at 10 o'clock. I mean, it's pretty hard if it doesn't get dark till 9:30 or not. I mean, till 8:30.
Can we just exempt movie night or something like that?
So that would just be
that?
A comment there.
It's about performance.
Movies, I don't think other than the Star Trek, we've had any complaints about movies. And the mix we've talked about. And the local performance issue is, you know, been brought up. That's we just a brief comment on that. Obviously, we've tried over the years to have local performers. There's a 100 kids in the play. That's the biggest part of it. The use of the stage for local performances, it goes into this conversation about use. And, you know, when do you put them on? You put them on before a show? Do you have more? It increases the intensity. It's not the main mission of the organization is not to have local performers. That has not ever been the mission of the Prescott Park Arts Festival. It's been access to quality arts. And Ben tries very hard to get as many in as he possibly can be, but I think it goes back to that same conversation about how much, where do you cut? If you're a financially viable organization with trying to reduce impact, you know, where's the balance?
I think that's one, though, as we look at a we've had a lot of pushback I have from the arts community about the festival, and that's the area.
Yeah.
You know, people are feeling, and of course, some people are misunderstanding that we are, as a city, paying for the arts festival and underwriting it, so some of it is related to that. But it's obviously anybody in the arts wants a stage, right? And
right.
So one of the things I think in an agreement going forward, we would need to be able to figure out how we would word this. You know, I know you do a lot of this already, where you like the showcases and whatever, but I think we'd want to come to specify sort of an expectation of X number of opportunities a year, something like that, that probably memorializes a lot of what's already happening, but kind of puts it, you know, makes it better known, or what the process would be for people who want to be a part of it, and formalizes that a little bit more.
So that, I just would comment that I, of course, personally, I think it's wonderful. I've always been a great advocate of encouraging and supporting local performances, but it does have a conflict with intensity of use
and
the timing and all the things we've just been talking about.
Well, it can.
It can. So how do you balance, again, it all goes back to financial viability, intensity of use, and these other goals and desires.
That's
you know, so that's, is that helpful?
Very good.
Yeah, I have gone. I the one thing I would really be helpful is we get the financials as soon as
we can. We will spend some more energy on
the 990.
That. Yeah, well, the 990 will get done as soon as the account. That's
990 is not going to tell us what you need to know.
But I'd still want both.
Yeah.
Well, that's not the festival dragging its feet. That's our an accountant.
Then give me unaudited financials.
Yeah. And we'll provide. I think we've got a message for the finance guys to work up some things. And
you have a budget that you've put together.
Yep.
If you could provide me that too, that'd be helpful.
All right.
Thank you, gentlemen.
All right, thank you.
Thanks for everybody else who showed up. Next Wednesday, 7:30, you're on.